Foodies Radio!
On today's show, Roger Miret stops by the Vicious Pig to talk about the new Agnostic Front album and also about cooking Cuban food.
Punk Rock Foodies Radio, your one-stop shop for everything punk rock, food, and that's pretty much it. With Xander T, Kevin Wells, Steve Guerrero, Brian Reinhardt, and now, Skate Rat Betty. Here's your host, Kevin Wells.
Welcome to another episode of Punk Rock Foodies Radio. That was the Bull Weevils with Fence Sitter. My name is Kevin Wells.
One of you guys.
Hi, I'm...
What's up? I'm Steve Guerrero.
I'm Skate Rat Betty.
And I'm Xander T, the asshole in charge of Punk Rock Foodies. Punk Rock Foodies is a Facebook group. We're an open group. We invite anybody to come on in and post food that you cook or you are about to eat at a restaurant. Just don't come in and just try to advertise your own shit or you'll be booted. But before we talk about the stuff we're going to talk about that you heard in the intro, we are going to listen to a little bit of music. This is Sick of Me by The Descendants.
Something's more on when it's good to meet our own demands. Every bubble put us to the test. I'm not good for your hair. Make your dreams turn into nightmares. I'll turn your mind into stone. When that one goes rolling, maybe you'll find one of your own. But if the villain need a rest, changing hands with a fist, tumble easily erupts. I hope the dead can stay. Doesn't understand the means justify the end. You can give me your love or your work, man. You can leave me all alone. Nothing stays the same, but some things never seem to change. When at the bottom of all the trash, such for the enemy. You can find it sacred state. What you know, they'll never be put to sleep. I wouldn't be so paranoid if the world wasn't out.
That was the Briggs with My Own Enemy. You're listening to Punk Rock Foodie Radio. I'm going to crack this beer here and give it over to the man in charge.
Hey, Steve, what song did we just listen to?
My Own Enemy. You guys didn't hear that part?
No. Sorry.
Did I not say it?
I don't know. I wasn't listening, maybe. But that's okay. Hey, it gets rowdy here at the Vicious Pig Saloon in downtown Mattersville. But, Punk Rock Foodies Radio. Today, we decided that, with it being St. Patty's week, in a sense, we're going to talk a little bit about St. Patrick's Day. Any food traditions or ways y'all have celebrated St. Patrick's Day in the past or are planning on it or just did, depending on when you're listening to this? Brian, this is the holiday of our people, alcoholics. So why don't you go first there, friend?
Okay, so as far as St. Patrick's Day, as far as traditions, and I guess I'll have to be the one who's the party pooper here, because let me tell you, I fucking hate St. Patrick's Day. I don't like it. I'm from Chicago, and St. Patrick's Day is huge in Chicago. Huge. So for years, my friends and I, we would go downtown, you know, the Southside Irish Parade, and all the bars are open. It's like Mardi Gras, except cold. And I never enjoyed it. It was horrible. There was just everyone, just douchebags wearing green. None of them are Irish. I'm not Irish either, but I guess you don't really need to be Irish to enjoy it. Just people fighting and peeing in the streets. And I know that sounds fun, but it's not. It's not fun. I'm a drinker. I love to drink. I drink as often as I can. I think I'm pretty good at it. It's amateur hour. And that's why I never wanted to go to Mardi Gras, because I don't want to see this level of douchebaggery. So that's what it always symbolized to me. Plus, I look bad in green. I just do. I don't know what it is. So I don't really have traditions. As far as the food, I can't think of any Irish food I like except potatoes. I don't know. Is that Irish? And the Shamrock Shake. Fuck you, McDonald's. You know, I don't hate McDonald's, but the Shamrock Shake sucks ass. So I'm sorry. I'm a big party pooper. But I'm wondering, you know, if only we knew somebody who was of a different culture, who might have a different take on it. Someone who's something weird like Mexican. Do we know any Mexicans? Hey, Steve,
Mexicans, we're down to party on any holiday, but, you know, like, some of those holidays are kind of amateur hours, so, but fortunately, there's been a tradition of the street dogs playing at House of Blues in Anaheim for the last, like, 3 years, so I've done that, and I'm doing that. I did that again last night, and it was awesome. I'm still hurting from it, but, yeah, it's, well, I guess that would be in the future. I don't even know what the fuck, but, yeah, I don't really have it. I per se don't have any Irish traditions that I do, you know? Like, I won't even drink green beer, you know? Maybe something with a green label, but... Green Flash, maybe, get something from them, but... for the most part, I'll probably eat a Mexican meal that night, just, you know, because I don't like. But what about you, Kevin? What are you into?
I'm into a lot of stuff. I'm pretty Irish. I have Irish roots on both sides that we trace back to Ireland, and we have a fair amount of... I don't know. We pretend like we're pretty Irish, I guess. Well, we are Irish, but we don't really care about, you know, I don't care about Irish issues. But we make there's an Irish soda bread that most people have. Like, it starts out like pretty plain, but then we will we add raisins and caraway seeds to it, and it kind of gives it a little bit of oomph. But I make that every year, and then other than that, I've done quite a bit of fun things because it's been St. Patrick's Day. Like, I saw Dropkick Murphys 1 year at 6 in the morning in L.A. at a bar in Hollywood. That kind of started off a pretty drunken day when you start off watching Dropkick Murphys at 6 in the morning. I've been to, you know, spring training for St. Patrick's Day. I'm assuming Skate Rat served me a beer in Vero Beach. We don't know for sure, but I had lots of them.
It probably happened.
But yeah, I don't know. I think there's a lot of, you know, it's kind of like the same thing as like Cinco de Mayo for a lot of people, where it's just like a reason to go out and get pretty shithoused on like a random Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, or, you know, if it's a weekend, there's usually the big like block party festival things going on. And but yeah, for the most part, it's I don't appreciate that aspect of it. But, you know, I'm like any other sucker. I like getting drunk with the rest of them.
any excuse. Right. Hey, Skate Rat, in your day, for those of you who don't know, Skate Rat has been sober for 72 years.
it feels like it.
But in your day, do you have any...
In your day. Way back in the 40s.
You know, hey, and I am like a 90-year-old person at heart, but I, you know, back in the day, I've done green beer. I honestly can taste food coloring. I swear to God.
Oh, yeah.
Everybody disagrees with me and says that you can't. I think you can. I don't like it. I hate the flavor of it. I, as a kid, would have nannies who would do, you know, green hot dogs. You would have green eggs in the morning and just... Now I can't. So now, you know, if anybody says, oh, green for St. Patrick's Day, I'm like, no, I'm good, thanks. But Guinness, stuff like that, I mean, yeah. I would drink European beers over a green beer, you know. But Irish whiskey, stuff like that, I didn't really touch that kind of stuff.
I I'm in a weird situation with St. Patrick's Day because my birthday is the 18th. So, yeah, well, so it's an extra day to celebrate.
Day after.
And I usually stretch it into the weekend. But
your birthday may even be right now as this airs for the first time.
It could be my birthday right now. Well, and then like, well, or it was yesterday, depending. but, you know, the one thing, like back in college, you know, the big thing was when you turn 21, go to the bar at midnight. Right, you know, as you turn 21, I'm like, I'm not gonna fucking go to a bar on St. Patrick's Day at midnight when every asshole, like Brian said, it's amateur hour, you know? Every asshole's out there drinking just because of St. Patrick's Day, so all these drunk idiots are gonna be at a bar, and I'm walking in sober. And so I just, fuck that. But I would do a shot of Irish whiskey and drink a Guinness in the morning with my breakfast, usually. Probably not this year since it's a Tuesday, or I might not have done it since it was on Tuesday.
Cop's boss listening.
But
I mean, I only do it when it falls on the weekend.
Absolutely. Or if it's a snow day from work. I was unlucky enough that my ex-wife was Irish, and her brother married a girl from Dublin, so I was lucky enough to go to the wedding, so I had what was probably the greatest fucking breakfast I've ever eaten in Ireland, and so I usually make that on St. Patrick's Day morning, and that's scrambled eggs, sausage links, or as they call them, bangers. If you'd like a banger in your mouth.
Banger in her mouth.
And then they take a tomato and they slice a tomato in half and then like sear it in a frying pan and baked beans and toast. And it's fucking delicious. It's an odd combination, but it's fucking great. It's like a traditional Irish breakfast with a Guinness.
Baked beans in the morning is fucking really, really good.
Yeah.
I'm a baked beans fan, period. But when I realized what they were doing over there, I was like, you motherfuckers are fucking geniuses.
Yep. But, yeah, and I usually, because I make it a whole birthday weekend celebration, I usually also will do, I gotta do a Reuben sandwich with the corned beef. So, and that's that, I mean, every year I've had one either on St. Patrick's Day or on my birthday. And that's just my, that's my go-to thing that time, like, this time of year.
I like the corned beef. I can eat it. I like to eat it. It tastes good. I can't stand the fucking smell of that shit cooking. And that shit stays in the house for days and days and days.
I have been banned from cooking it. If I want corned beef and cabbage, I have to go out. My husband hates it, so he doesn't even want me to cook it here because, like you said, for 3 days, he's like, shit, it still smells like farts and cabbage. I'm over this.
See, it's been a while since I've actually, like, done a brisket, like, in a crock pot, especially since I lost the crock pot in the divorce.
Did you get the record player, though?
Priorities, man.
Of course I got the record player. Actually, no, I didn't. No, actually, I didn't. The record player, the turntable itself broke, so I left it and bought a new one. But
way to stick it to him.
But yep. But I do like the crock pot of corned beef. I like it. I'll do it and not even eat it that night. I'll put it in the fridge and then slice it up and throw it on some bread with some mustard. And I think that alone is just fucking delicious. But typically, when I'm making my Reubens, I'll just buy some slices of corned beef at the deli and. That's that. Plus, I hate Swiss cheese, except on Reubens, so I just buy, like, two slices of that, because I'm not going to do anything else with it.
Really? So. You don't put it on a bevy of other sandwiches?
No, I'm not, I don't know, something about Swiss cheese. I
mean, ham and even, Swiss? Ham and Swiss is like, yeah. It goes together like ham and Swiss.
Nah, yeah, I something about the flavor. Nope. I'm a cheese whore, I love cheese, but Swiss just, I don't know.
It does not like you're a cheese whore. A cheese whore would take down the Swiss by the foot.
I hate Swiss. No, I hate it. I wouldn't eat provolone for years.
Man, missing out. I like them in cordon bleus. They're delicious, and you know,
I love chicken cordon bleu. I love chicken cordon bleu. I don't know, just having like a slice of Swiss cheese. Maybe it's when it's raw, like melted. Is I think so. Obviously, I like it, but
I got you. You know what? When it gets melty, it gets that nice creamy kind of texture. It's really good. It's a texture thing too with Swiss. You know.
Oh, absolutely.
One of my favorite all-time sandwiches from McDonald's was the chicken bacon ranch with Swiss.
That was good, yeah.
I could, yeah.
But yeah, like you don't eat Swiss, like you wouldn't grab a slice of Swiss cheese, just eat it like you'd see a mouse doing in a cartoon. But
well, and the only reason the Swiss is in the cartoon is because of the holes, and that's how you know it's cheese, as opposed to like a triangle piece of wood. You know?
As opposed to the 99% of other cheeses that don't have holes in it.
Exactly.
And I'm curious, while we're on the topic of St. Patrick's Day, has anybody ever bought already made sauerkraut? I always make mine with
corned beef.
They
mean like in a
bag? Yeah, but they sell it like in a bag.
Oh, that's all I ever use.
Really? I've never tried it.
I've never cut up cabbage to make sauerkraut.
I don't eat sauerkraut. Isn't that German? Is that Irish?
No, it's both. Both. Miriam, when we go
European.
To Austria, we eat a lot of sauerkraut, but we never make it at home.
Hungary, too, I think, right?
Well, I'm sure my grandma on my dad's side has made it. I'm sure. I mean, every time we ever went over, there was a roast and there was cabbage. So I'm sure she made it, but I always just figured that's how you did it. You got it in a bag.
I figured it came in a jar.
I won't buy it in the jar. I don't know why. I'll only buy it in the bag.
I was wondering if, like, for sandwiches, if that was going to be the way to go, though, is just buy it hard.
What I do is I'll take it when I make the Reuben. I take it and I drain it.
Yeah.
And then I mix it with Thousand Island dressing.
Instead of separately.
And then I still put the Thousand Island on, but I mix it together. But, sauerkraut in a bag. I like things in a bag.
I think for me, because I've only seen it in a jar, it kind of falls into my food phobia of foods and water in jars. Or foods and liquids in jars, I should say. Like any pickled things, any of that shit. And it just, I don't know. I was like, I don't need to put that shit on my hot dog.
Well, okay. So, you know, St. Patrick's Day is basically a drinking holiday. Like, even like Brian said, like Mardi Gras, you know. And like Kevin said, an excuse to drink on a weekday.
What kind of alcoholic are you if you need a fucking excuse to drink on a weekday?
Well, exactly.
How great must your life be, asshole?
It's a fucking weekday today and we're all drinking, so, well, most of us. Skate rap. So actually, we're going to head off to a song now, take a little break, and when we come back, we're going to pick up the conversation about drinking and eating. And so, you know, speaking of St. Patrick's Day, one of my traditions, I always listen to the Real McKenzies on St. Patrick's Day. So here is some Real McKenzies with My Mangy Hound. You're listening to Punk Rock Foodies Radio on punkrockradio.net.
Somebody's lunch was scattered around the playground. A mangy hound was dragging it around. We laughed, cause some poor sucker had lost a lunch he was given by his mother. My soul will burn eternally, for in that lunch was stuff mom made for me. For me. The custodian was called to the scene. She looked at me and read me like a magazine. She laughed until she discovered the nice lunch I was given by my mother was torn and shredded hopelessly. And the dog that ate the lunch mom made for me. For me. I am the kid with a spotty ravenella. I had a lunch with a liverwurst sandwich. But now the corn scattered all around the playground. My dirty old mangy hound. Much later, safe in my room. Suffer, my soul was filled with sympathy. From that night on, that dog has lived with me. Lived with me. I was a kid with a spotty ravenella. I had a lunch with a liverwurst sandwich. But now the corn scattered all around the playground. My dirty old mangy hound. I was a kid with a spotty ravenella.
Sentences, my mind's on constant roam. That's because my mother choked when I was in her womb. I got diagnosed with fecal alcohol syndrome. My mother gave me shit for praise and fucked up chromosomes.
Mother gave him shit for praise and fucked up chromosomes.
For people is that I'm not very smart. If I couldn't affect my kidneys, liver, or my heart, they see through the umbilical and cross every membrane. She's stay drunk, so I'm a punk with a retarded brain.
She's stay drunk, now he's a punk with a retarded brain.
And finish with Bolat. The wine turned into whiskey, the cigarettes to pot. And then she moved to opiates, then methamphetamine. Oh, she stayed wasted, I got stuck with a sub-average brain.
She got wasted, he got stuck with a sub-average brain.
My favorite baby bottle was Kahlua and breast milk. And when I turned to toddler, she gave me gin and juice. Now I can mix my own drinks of fruit and champagne. I was a newborn alcoholic with a fermented brain.
A newborn alcoholic with a fermented brain.
Yeah. It was a fecal alcoholic host. And I would have done the same.
It was a fecal alcoholic host, and he would have done the same.
Yeah. All right. No, seriously, let's go to the bar. It's down this way.
Welcome back. That was Fecal Alcohol Syndrome from the Home Street Home soundtrack, the Fat Mike musical. Speaking of alcoholicisms and drinkings and all that stuff, people often find themselves hungry after they've drinking beverages. What kind of bar foods do you guys kind of tend to lean towards when you're drinking? I personally don't like to eat anything when I'm drinking. I like to leave all the room for the alcohol I can possibly get as drunk as possible.
You like to drink when you drink.
I like canwiches. And yeah, I mean, I start drinking and then I eat food and then I just realize I just wasted all that money on beer that I just sopped up, you know, with all the food that I just wasted more money on that food now. So it's just, you know, if you're gonna go out and do something, you know, pick one. Don't sit there and I'll have some food, I'll have another drink. What's the point? Get drunk and, you know, fucking deal with it later in the morning.
When, as far as bar food, when I'm in a bar, when I'm sitting at the bar, I need food that, I need food that's not too heavy. So when I was younger, I used to always go and just order the biggest burger on the menu. And it was good, but two things happened. A, I would end up a mess. Like, I just have food all over me. And two, it would fill me up, so I didn't have enough room for beer. And beer is why we're there, gentlemen. So that seemed counterproductive. So as I got older and I did more field research in the bars, I found that the best thing for me was either chips and salsa or buffalo wings. One of the two. I mean, sometimes both. Because I can eat, I can eat 50 wings and still drink beers with the best of them. So the burgers, I basically avoid meal items. I just stick to snack foods. I stick to pub grub. So give me some wings, give me some quesadillas, give me some chips and salsa, but nothing beyond that because I need to be able to drink my 400 beers and, you know, not be too full because that's why we're there.
Hey, Brian, I totally agree with you. You know, wings can kind of, you know, get you a little satisfied, you know, put a little food in your stomach, but you can kind of keep powering through, you know. Those are good at any time. If I'm lucky enough to be somewhere at happy hour and I'm putting down beers and they got like a ceviche or like a tuna ahi poke, man, that would be my go-to right then and there. But if it's late night, you know, In-N-Out or a big greasy burger would probably be the call. You know, In-N-Out's, you know, definitely one of my favorite. I don't really do much fast food, so like, you know, I try to keep it to a minimum, but In-N-Out's always going to be there, and it's always going to be a craving for me. So that after, you know, a few hundred of beers or whatever, I could put down a nice greasy burger would probably do the trick.
I'll eat wings while I drink beer. I think they get a great combination, especially if you get something spicy, and that beer is really good to cool it down a little bit. But as far as, like, I don't know, I mean, almost anything fried is great. A nice, you know, mozzarella sticks. Give me that creamy cheese and the fried breading on the outside. I'll take that anytime. And, you know, I think one of the things that I've just recently kind of gotten into is cheese fries. Mm. Cheese fries with some bacon crumbled up on top and maybe some green onions. It's like Irish nachos.
That's actually what they call them in bars. They call them Irish nachos.
Well, I guess it hasn't made it out east yet. But, I mean, that's even... I'm not a real big on that one, but I've just started getting into it. But fried stuff, it just, you know, it always is good. It's, you know, that, I think it's like you said, Steve, that greasy, like a greasy burger, you know, getting that grease. But after getting drunk, though, when I was in college, we had a pizza place. I swear to God, it's like they didn't even have to open until 11 o'clock at night. That's probably when they did their most business. They had the best fucking drunk pizza and a ranch dipping sauce that they put with that pizza. It was so fucking good. It was just, he's... I mean, it was looked good coming in and it looked good coming out. You know, it was that good.
The main thing I always had to watch out for with delivery places, though, like pizza, was the delivery. If I'm not picking shit up on the way home and I'm saying, hey, meet me there in an hour, I'm not awake. That's not going to happen. When you ring on that doorbell, nobody is going to
It's a very valid point.
I have already made fried eggs Very and gone to point. Sleep.
Kevin, what kind of sandwich do you dig into?
As far as like being wasted, like at the end of the day, like or end of the evening.
Yeah,
wasted at the end of the day. But the greatest
like
thing
at
I've
4 o'clock?
Ever had was from Jack in the Box. You have to create it yourself. You get the a Jumbo Jack with cheese. And you go there with a buddy, you know. You have all night to make a buddy. Make a buddy to go to Jack in the Box with you at the end of the night. So you get a Jumbo Jack with cheese. Each of you get a Jumbo Jack with cheese. And then together you guys order the two tacos for 99 cents. One person gets a taco each. You take the taco out, take out the bun, put the taco inside the Jumbo Jack, put the bun back. Boom, you got the Taco Jack.
You know what? You've posted that before on Punk Rock Foodies.
Yes. It's the greatest invention ever. Now, Jack in the Box took the idea and made fun of it in a commercial. They called it the Jumbaco, and I had really hurt feeling. I got excited when I started seeing it, and then they started joking around that it wasn't real, and I was like, oh, you fucking assholes.
Is that when they had those stoner commercials for a while there? I remember
that was after the stoner commercials.
See, we don't have Jack in the Box here, so I don't.
Yeah, no, I don't really? Get them either. So that sucks. But
you guys have like Jim in the Box, because like there's Carl's Jr. and Hardee's, but like is there like an equivalent or not even at all?
No,
Jim in the Box.
Hardee's here aren't good though. Hardee's in the South aren't places you want.
You know what's funny though? My brother, when my brother's out in like where the fuck he was, Wyoming or South Dakota or some shit, he was working. He and his wife went to Burger King and Taco Bell, and they just kind of, I think he did that little combo himself.
So when my ex was pregnant, she had she wanted to get Burger King or something, and I was like, okay, well, it's right near Jack in the Box, so I'll go get Jack in the Box. Or no, Taco Bell. So I pull over, I get Taco Bell drive-thru for myself, and then we go over to the Burger King. And I ended up ordering stuff for myself from Burger King as well. And then she, being pregnant, was like, oh, KFC is next door. Let's go there, too. I want to get something there from there. So then, third stop, I got something from KFC as well. So that was my best fast food experience. And I wasn't drunk, though. I was on performance enhancers.
The McDonald's has come out with a jalapeno double burger.
I saw that.
Something, it's actually not bad. My husband brought one home.
It?
It's like a double cheeseburger, but it's a jalapeno double cheeseburger.
Ooh.
And it's actually got a little spice to it. I'm pretty sure they're like the pickled jalapenos, but
of course,
for the most part, you know, I stay away from them. But man, I tell you, if I was still drinking, I would fuck those things so hardcore.
Is that a value menu item?
No, it can't be.
I don't know.
No,
I don't know.
Well, because I mean, the double cheeseburger is like $1.29 or something, isn't it?
Yeah, for 70 cents more, you get jalapenos on it.
Don't get me started on their cheeseburger issue. Every time I go there, I just want a plain fucking cheeseburger with bacon on it, and they give me a double cheeseburger because it's the same price. I don't give a shit if it's the same price. I'm not going to eat it. I just want a single cheeseburger.
They're trying to work you out.
That doesn't make sense to them. Like, why wouldn't you?
They're trying to save you money.
The same.
I can't eat it.
So eat half of it.
I tried. I'm big on like the bun to meat ratio. Once it gets to, like double meat or you got triple buns in there, I'm not dealing with that.
You can only eat so much kangaroo meat.
I know a couple guys that are into the bun to meat ratio too, but different conversation.
Hey-o.
Hey, you know what? I was just thinking about this. We used to go to this club in Pittsburgh called Club Laga. It doesn't exist anymore, but I mean, I've seen so many fucking bands there. Friends of Rom, the Queers, Mr. T Experience, the Nobodies. I saw Blink 182 there before Blink 182 was famous and shit. My buddy lived right down the road because he went to...
But were they already Blink 182?
They still were Blink 182.
That was back when they had good music, though, right?
It was like when Cheshire Cat came out. So it was like before...
Was it before the 182 was added as well?
No, they were 182 at that point, yeah. But they were opening for, I think, less than Jake, actually. But anyway, we would go to... It was like my buddy lived like 4 blocks away from this club because he went to University of Pittsburgh. And like halfway between was a pizza place that he delivered for. And they had a takeout plain cheese pizza for $4 large.
Damn.
And we would go to that. We'd go to the club and go to the shows, get drunk, and then walk back to his place and stop in, order the pizza. And we'd like eat half of it in the 2 blocks it took to get from the pizza place to his house. And then continue to get shitty and pass out on the couch. So...
They had Little Caesars in Portland where you can get $5 takeout pizzas, but
nice.
It was in Portland and you couldn't walk there.
You had to swim.
If you were drunk, you weren't going to walk anywhere near to where that place was.
I mean, that was the goal. Get you there. But
I just want to get drunk enough so I don't want to walk anywhere in Portland.
All right, well, there's your drunk food conversation. Speaking of, I think I'd like to get some food. We do have Roger. How do you say his name? Miret. It's
Roger Miret.
Miret. Yeah, I mean, from Agnostic Front, it will be joining us after this break. Skate Rat, you got a song or?
I do. Turbo Negro, I got erection.
All right.
Just got erection.
Right here on Punk Rock Foodies Radio on punkrockradio.net.
I'm
back to Punk Rock Foodies Radio. That was Agnostic Front with Police Violence. That comes off the new record, The American Dream Died, which you can pick up on April 7th on Nuclear Blast. Right now, we have a special guest for the show. It's Roger Miret from Agnostic Front. Roger, thank you for joining us.
Hey, Kevin. How are you?
I'm doing well. Thanks for taking the time to talk to me. I appreciate it.
You're welcome.
Now, if you talk to most hardcore bands today, if not all of them, they'll all kind of credit Agnostic Front as their main influence or one of their main influences. What bands influenced you when you were first getting into it?
My main influences are directly linked to punk rock, obviously. You know, the Clash is a very big main influence to me. And others would be like the Dead Kennedys, Circle Jerks, Black Flag, Bad Religion, Bad Brains, all the bands we were kind of working at starting at the same time, your Negative Approaches, your Suicidal Tendencies, your Minor Threats. I mean, these are bands kind of we all grew up with each other and made a big impact in my life.
Mm-hmm. Now, are there bands today, new hardcore bands today, that influence you?
You know, today, it's tough because I don't know, you know, like, every time I come home, I hear there's a lot of great new bands, like Coldside, Florida, what do you call them, from, I mean, there's a lot of newer bands that I do like. Backtrack from New York is another great band. It's just that even when I come home, I still find myself back to basics, you know what I mean?
Mm.
You know, I still come back home and go back to the original things and, you know, bands that I've loved. That's what I listen to, really.
Right.
No matter what.
Okay. Now, you've got a new album coming out, American Dream. Did you guys try anything different in the way that you either approached writing or recording the record?
The recording was done a little bit different this time. The writing was pretty much similar. We went in to the studio with seven solid songs that we knew how to play very well and were very familiar with. And we wrote one right there in the studio, which is the intro to The American Dream Died.
Okay.
And then the remaining eight, I had, you know, they were already written, but they were more kept as a surprise to the band, so we wouldn't lose that that initial impact of listening to the song. What do you feel? Put it down on tape.
Okay.
Kind of to capture that right. Rowdiness and that chaotic thing, which I call the old school Sunday matinee session, which are the fastest songs you hear on the record. You know, they're kind of rowdy and kind of like, you know, they're raw.
Okay. Now, as far as recording it, what did you guys do differently recording?
Recording, we definitely, well, we all were in the same room. We always record kind of live as we're all in the same room. I do vocals afterwards, or if I need a guide vocal, I'll do it before. Half the record, which is interesting, was half the record has a click kind of a track.
Okay.
To make, and the other half, the crazy rowdy stuff, had none. So that's the only thing that was really done differently.
Okay. Now, are you guys going to be, excuse me, are you going to be touring pretty extensively on this record?
Well, as extensively as we can, because we're all family, men, we all have children, so we can't go jump in a van and disappear for 3 months like a lot of the newer hardcore bands can do, and we did that too. It's just that now as fathers and family people ourselves, we need to keep coming back home, make sure our homes are safe and everything's fine, and plus we keep our own jobs too. We can't disappear for so long, and you know, we're not living like we used to live, like in squats or at home or anything. So now we have to make sure we come home and keep our jobs, too.
Right.
That's time to go back, you know? So there's a lot of different responsibilities. But yes, we do plan on doing as much as we can.
Does touring get easier for you at this point? Or is it harder, you know, now with family, having to mix all that in?
Well, it's harder with the family because I miss them and I want to be home with them. And, but the minute I see the guys and we're on the road, it's great to see the guys. They're all my family, too. And it's great to see friends I've made worldwide and on different countries, you know what I mean? So that aspect of it is great. Just getting there is kind of a bummer because I'm missing my family.
Right.
And at the same time, getting back home is just as intense because I can't wait to see my family and my kids. And it just, it, I guess it rounds me. I need a little bit of both just to feel good, you know?
Yeah. Now, are you the kind of type of person who will try weird foods, you know, from various places when you're touring?
That's me. I want to eat with the people. I want to eat with the people eat. What? I'm not going to McDonald's. I never did. I ain't doing it. You know what I mean?
Yep. What's the strangest thing you've eaten?
Live on national TV in Japan. It was the funniest thing in the world. Of course, it's a different, completely different culture. They gave me rotten tofu. And it was a live TV show, Japanese food show. And I ate it, and they're like, what do you think? And I'm like, oh, it's good. I was just being polite. You know, and then they all start laughing. I'm like, you ate rotten tofu, and I wanted to kill them. You know? And then they went and gave me something else, which was horse.
Horse?
Yeah, horse meat. Which, and then they laughed at me. I was just trying to be nice. Oh, Jesus Christ. That was probably some of the weirdest shit I've ever eaten. And that was probably around 19... It was probably around 2000, around that era, when we were still on Epitaph. I'm sure you may be able to find this live TV show. I've never seen it, to be to be real with you. But I don't know, it was live national TV in Japan. It was the funniest thing they thought. I was pissed off.
What did horse taste like?
You know, I don't even want to remember. I can't. I probably erased it out of my mind. And I don't know. You know, I just don't know, you know? I'm sure I've eaten it again. I ate it again once in Italy. And I wasn't too pleased about it, you know? Like, it was just like, you know, you eat this, feel like if somebody's family said, oh, man, girl, Jesus, you know? I don't know. I like to keep it to basics when it comes to that. Most of the time, 80% of them, I prefer seafood stuff and more likely vegetarian stuff than challenging any meats or poultry or anything like that.
Okay. Do you ever do any cooking for yourself when you're on tour?
Yeah, basics again, because if we always take a frying pan and we always make like omelets and breakfast and stuff like that, but other than that, no. I do all the cooking at home, but I love cooking at home.
What's your favorite thing to cook at home?
Well, I'm Cuban, so everything I cook is Cuban cuisine style.
Awesome.
Like black beans, and I make an amazing flan. My daughter knows how to make it now. She's 7. She got it.
Awesome.
you know, I make all the classics: picadillo, arroz con pollo, fricase de pollo. Just the classics. Cubans, I can make all that food, and. It's my favorite. It's what we, I really enjoy grilling, and again, I only grill fish, which is probably not a good way to say you enjoy grilling, because I always do a lot of grilled beef and all that stuff, but that's not my cup of tea. I enjoy grilling fishes and stuff like that.
Okay. So that's got to benefit you quite a bit now that you're out in Arizona, right? Get grilling season. Now that you're out living in Arizona, you got grilling season all year, right?
Pretty much. When it gets hot, you don't even put the damn thing on. Just put whatever you want in there. It'll be cooked.
Just throw it on the driveway.
It's pretty good. Like, you want to grow as much as you can. This is a good set time right now. And then when it gets hot, you know, every time it gets hot, no matter where I am, when I was in New York City, same thing. I'm one of those that I gravitate toward, like, cold foods in the summer, which would be like a nice cold soup of some sort. Or sandwiches and cold stuff, hummus, you know, stuff that's easy.
Yeah.
For some reason, I don't want to eat much heavier and hot stuff. It doesn't sit well with me in the summer.
Gotcha. Yeah, I agree. Well, awesome, man. That's pretty much all I got for you today. Is there anything else you want people to know, either about yourself or anything else you're working on?
No, that's good enough. And this is probably the best interview I did all day. Thank you for not asking the same question every fucking person asked me today.
Awesome, thank you. I appreciate that.
I'm getting ready to stick my head through a fucking window. I can't take it.
Well, good. Make sure you tell John that I did that.
All right, man. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you, man. I appreciate it.
Cheers.
You're listening to Punk Rock Foodies Radio on punkrockradio.net. This is Morning Glory with War Dance.
We're all strands of a thread. We're connected to one giant web. When we decide to hurt ourselves, so we hurt everyone else.
yeah, thanks, Kev. Yeah, that's it for us here on Punk Rock Foodies Radio on punkrockradio.net from the Vicious Pig Saloon. I'd like to thank the people at the Vicious Pig Saloon in downtown Mattersville for having us. I'd like to thank Skate Rap Eddie, Kevin Will, Steve Guerrero, and Brian Reinhardt for hanging out. I'd like to thank Roger Merritt of Agnostic Front for that interview. That was great. Thanks to the boys down under in with punkrockradio.net for having us, And I would also like you to check out Burning Rose Studios and Emmer Epper Records. And of course, look for us on Facebook. We are Punk Rock Foodies, nearly 3,000 members strong. Don't be fooled by imitators. We are the original. So have yourselves a good week. Have yourselves a good night. Donate to everyone.
To the imitation zone. Forget it, brother. You can go it alone. London calling to the zombies of death. Quit holding out and draw another breath. London calling, and I don't want to shout. But while we were talking, I saw you nodding out. London calling, see, we ain't got no hide. Except for that one with the yellowy eyes. The ice is coming, the sun's zooming in. Engine stuck on it, the wheat is going thin. A nuclear error, but I have no fear. Cause London is drowning out.
Thank you.